Good morning, everybody. We shall start. Thanks for coming. You are quite numerous, but that's good. As you know, my name is Laszlo Toth from Lorraine University in Metz, from France. And I'm happy to see you, so many young people, so that I can present some of my work. It's always a pleasure to speak about your own work, you know. This is why when you give a lecture, it usually you run out of time, because you have many things to speak about. As you could see, I already modified the title twice, because I just realized that what we are going to do during this course is not only modeling, but also simulation, and not only crystal plasticity, but also application on textures. You know, modeling and simulation, it's not really the same thing. They are not synonyms. Modeling is when you establish principles from which you construct an approach, and elements are many elements are analytical in it. You build up something, and that model is then working for hopefully for reproducing some experimental features. Simulation is not the same thing. Simulation, we call it when you already have some softwares, some programs which are available, and you are actually just using them, and then you simulate with already existing model. Of course, behind the simulation simulation software, there is a model. But you are not doing the modeling part. Somebody else already constructed it for you, and then you are a user. So, but user, actually, it's important to be a good user, a user who is well informed. Now we can distinguish, in terms of user, different levels. You can be, well, you know, when you have a simulation code which is available for you, it can be just for you a black box, and you know what to put in, you will know what it comes out, but you don't know what is happening in between in the code. So that's the user I call level number one, perhaps level zero, in terms of knowledge within the code. Let's say level zero. Now, of course, you have to be a little bit better. Level number one, we shall call a user who knows a little bit what are the principles in that black box. What is it doing, more or less? At least the basics of it. So that is a level number one user. Level two would be somebody who is quite well informed about what is in the code. So he understands all of these details, the theory which is behind and so on. A well informed user. So when he is getting results, he knows which part would affect, if I change this parameter or that, would affect the results in a certain way. That's level number two. Now, of course, the best is, at I call level number three. We are already at four levels, yeah? Level number three is actually able to modify the code. If you got the source code, you can put new things in it. And that is really very interesting. You can touch the code of somebody else and then put something what you want to get out, what you are interested in, and which is making a new point. So you are level number three. There is even one more level, that's level number 4, when it's you who is making the code. So you can, you are able to build it up from scratch, from zero. Then of course, you know absolutely everything, and then you are the master. So that's about the codes. We will talk about, an interesting code, which is the major application, which makes the major application of what we are going to talk about today, the viscoplastic self-consistent polycrystal code. We will know how to use it, and we will be able to manage to get out many things out of it. And I would like that you become, a high level of user. Well, during this short time, I think we can certainly switch from level 0, to level 1 or perhaps even 2. Level how about this? Was it 5? Not 4. Level 4, I don't think will be possible, but that needs a whole evolution. So this is what we are planning. Modeling and simulation is extremely important because, what is the source of knowledge, of course, is experiment, observation. That's the knowledge that we get. But the understanding of all this, what we see, can easily go with the way of modeling. So, as I said, establishing principles, like in mathematics, and then from those axioms, you can build up a whole system of modeling. So it's important to do that. I know that you are doctoral students, most of you, and you have to publish. The way of succeeding in science now is publishing good papers. So the best paper, what are the best successful papers? You can have a look at them. Most of them are a combination of experiment and modeling or simulation. The best paper I would define, which shows most of the capacities also of the authors, then there is experiment, a new model, so modeling, and its application successfully on the existing results, and moreover, if there is previous modeling, then application of those previous models of other people, and to show that they work less good. Such a paper is the top. Of course, you are not obliged to publish always these kinds of papers. It's very difficult. You cannot make for each of your communications a new model. But you can simply, it is justified, only publish experimental observations. It's perfectly fine. It's important. Important to give the opportunity to other people to read it, and then they can use it for modeling, simulation, or whatever, or technical evolution. It is very useful. A paper which is only on modeling, so theoretical paper, is also possible. You don't have to make always the whole chain of possibilities in one single paper. But anyway, we are going to focus on in this course mostly, of course, on the modeling and then simulation. In the modeling of crystal plasticity and applications on textures. And in the modeling part, of course, we will be starting from the basics. What is the basic problem? Here we speak about crystal plasticity. Well, plasticity is already, you know, it's mechanics. So I assume a certain knowledge, certainly there is, in mechanics for that purpose. Not too much needed. And of course, mathematics. Well, mechanics is nothing else as applied mathematics, basically. So good mathematical knowledge is very useful. But I will present, when needed, all the necessary principles for that. So let's start with the beginning. What is the basic problem of mechanics? Because crystal plasticity is mechanics. Well, I prefer to present it in this way, as here, that mechanics is basically dealing with two things. One is the stress state. What is the stress, so what is the charge, loading on the material? And the other is the resulting deformation. So one is the strain, the other is the stress. One possibility, what is a problem to solve, is made like this. We impose the strain state in terms of usually in tensorial quantity in each given point of the material, or it might be homogeneous for simplicity, and which has 9 components. And then we want to obtain what is going to be the response of the material in terms of stresses. So what will be the stress components in the stress tensor in each of the points where we are interested in? You see, that's a very classical. All components of the strain are known. None of the components of the stress are known. So for in each point, we have 9 variables, 9 state variables to obtain here for the stress. That's one configuration. The other configuration is when we impose fully the stress state on the material, and we want to obtain what is going to be the response of the material in terms of strain. So you see, in that case, the stress components, the 9 stress components of the stress tensor, are known. And we want to get the strain. None of the components are known. You see, this is a kind of complementary. One is inverse to the other. This we can talk about in terms of experiments. And in experiments, we can really define what we impose. Both cases is possible in experiment. For example, a tensile test, a sample by doing, you know, just a simple tensile test, we can control it in terms of loading. We impose a loading as a function of time, or we impose a displacement as a function of time. Both of them are just one of the other. But it is nice when all these components, you know, here are imposed, and then we get actually all of them here. In the measurement, usually we do not measure all of them. We are not in the capacity of measuring. Some of them are going to be measured. It's the same case here. So, but these I call the simple cases. That one, in theory, when we do this in theory, that's called the upper bound approach. And this one is called the lower bound approach in mechanics. But the real case is not like that, usually. The real is down here below. Look at that one. When parts of the stress state, part of the stress state is known, and part of the strain state is known. They are always complementary. So I look here, for example, the diagonal components of the strain and two of the non-diagonal are imposed, and then some of the shear components here, where there is question mark, they are not known. And and parallel, each time when something is imposed, there's a question mark for the stress state. It is actually, for material behavior, not possible to prescribe the same thing in terms of stress and strain. That's not we who decide about how the material should behave. Exactly this is the, it belongs to the material behavior. The material will give the response. You cannot impose anything on a material. For example, any stress state cannot be imposed on a given material. You cannot be, for example, outside of the yield surface. You can be inside. There are restrictions. So this is why it's not possible that the same thing, for example, sigma 11 here and epsilon 11 there, both of them are imposed initially and known. They are usual, of course, they are complementary. One is imposed, the other can be calculated. So this is the general problem what we usually solve, and so that is called the mixed boundary value problem. All these here, these are boundary conditions. This is imposed, not imposed, all this is basically boundary condition. So this is how it goes. In crystal plasticity, it will be the same, because this is mechanics also. So we will work in this way. That's going to be, for example, in polycrystal plasticity, the so-called Taylor model. This one in polycrystal plasticity, the static model. And then that one here, what we have, let's say, the self-consistent model. Or can be kind of relaxed constraints, Taylor kind of model. We will learn all these, what they mean during the course. So I will start with some basics, and then we will build all this up. Oh yeah, that's what I wanted to show you already here. For the material behavior, an example that the yield surface, we are going to use the yield surface concept in crystal plasticity. It's very useful. It makes the connection also between the stress and the strain rate, not the strain itself, but the instantaneous state. And it also shows what are the limitations for the possible stress states, what you can apply on the material. Sigma, the stress state, can be only inside this surface or on the surface. But it cannot be outside the surface. The material, if it displays this yield surface, is unable to sustain loading which is outside the yield surface. And here we are only in just two dimensions. So one component of the stress and one component of the strain rate are plotted in a superimposed reference system. But the problem is much more complex, of course, each time. Both the stress and the strain are at least nine components, so tensorial quantities. You represent them in terms of matrices. So this is showing a little bit graphically what is the basic problem of plasticity. is that either we know this and then we will get that one. Here on a singular crystal, this is a singular crystal yield surface. Looks to be quite easy because it's always perpendicular. So somehow they are related. More difficult when we know this one and want to get that one, because we only know the vector and we have to find where it is going to touch the yield surface to find the sigma. That's for the singular crystal behavior. That's also applicable to general plasticity, like any kind of von Mises or Tresca or Bishop and Hill just Hill surface. They are all these principles, of course, they are the same. Now, another thing. The modeling and simulation scheme in crystal plasticity. So our topic is crystal plasticity. What we are going to need, what is the objective of this course? I would like to make you an expert of simulation in polycrystal plasticity to obtain the textures and then stress and strain response of the material. Lots of information, incredible amount of information you can dig out using crystal plasticity. Much more than in traditional phenomenological plasticity. What you will need to do the modeling, the input is given here. We need a good code, but we have to execute. So this is the black box, actually, here in the middle. And we will have the outputs. So input in crystal plasticity, you don't have to know how the crystals are oriented. You have to have at least one crystal. Okay, and if you have one, then you are just doing single crystal plasticity. Then you don't need a polycrystal model. For polycrystals, you need a set of grain orientations representing the polycrystal. And of course, we have plenty of modern techniques to obtain that. We can directly measure them by, for example, EBSD to get an orientation map even of the surface of the material. We can do even use other X-ray and other techniques to get even in 3D the orientation distribution within the bulk of the material with high energy synchrotron X-ray radiation, for example. So, of course, knowing this, it has a history to get to this point, to obtain that. Then, you have to know your crystal. The crystal has, for plastic deformation, the possibility of slip. It also has the possibility to deform by twinning. Of course, then there is also diffusion, grain boundary, sliding. These or transformations, different mechanisms more. We are not going to see all of them because of time. But the most important ones, these ones, we will, of course, examine. They are the most important. Slip and twinning systems in the crystal. And then you have to specify what loading you are applying on the material. If we work with the strain imposed case, so we know all the components of the strain, or at least most of them, then we will need the so-called velocity gradient of a material element, what is its history during large strain as a function of time. So we need a gradient tensor, the velocity gradient tensor. It's not the strain tensor what we need. It's not the strain rate either. Specifically, we call and I will precisely define during the course the so-called velocity gradient of the material element, and we follow, we want to get the response of that material element during its history of deformation. We have to know how it is followed and how it is changing as a function of time. That's simply 9 quantities as a function of time, at least, that we put into the code. If we have that, then we are good. Then, of course, we have to know what is in it, in this model, to control so-called parameters of the modeling. The modeling requires, for example, the strain hardening, requires quite a number of parameters. So we have to go into study how crystal plasticity is taking into account strain hardening. Very important. So you have to put these parameters in it. You have to specify your constitutive laws. The constitutive laws itself, which are probably fixed in the model, they themselves, they have parameters. You have to know them, their meaning. So we look into the meaning to understand if I change this or that, what is expected to happen, what is behind. So you have to be at least level one or two users concerning this, the black box. Of course, you have to specify and make sure that you have enough memory and all the variables are defined with sufficient dimension. So this is the preparation work. Of course, this preparation work is after another preparation work, which involves experiments, studies, and so on. You know, there is a whole chain. But you are basically, when you are here at doctoral studies, in research, you are already here. All the rest, what is needed, how to obtain orientation distribution, you are already able. And then you just press the button for the code. It will give some outputs. The outputs then these are the results, of course. The results themselves can contain the following information. You will know the grain orientations after deformation. You specified before. Now you will know what are these orientations after. Directly you can compare to experiment. And it is three-dimensional. I mean, the orientation is 3D. And you can also measure in 3D the so-called orientation distribution functions, which are called textures for materials. And you can compare them. But attention, it's a comparison in 3D. It's not like it's just one curve in which you basically have to get agreement in one dimension. It is in 3D. So you will be happy to see if there will be, at some point, there is agreement. And then you will change the parameters, and you will be more and more happy to see it is getting better and better. But it's 3D. This is also why it is, once you get a very good result in the simulation, you get nearly the same which is measured experimentally in 3D. There are so many agreements, so much agreement then between the experiment and modeling, that basically it's almost sure that what is in it, which produced that result, is really the working mechanism. So all these twinning and slip systems and hardening and so on were correct. And all these mechanisms are really working in the material. That's the power of crystal plasticity. The results can make you sure that what is physics behind is sure it is true. What else you will get? So you get orientation distribution called ODF. You get slip system activity. The code will tell you grain by grain what kind of slip systems were deforming how much, twinning systems how much. All this is coming out. You get, of course, the stress response of each of the grains. Not only the polycrystal, of course, you get the stress response of the polycrystal, which can be plotted. This one is just one curve. But you also get grain by grain. And you can see what are the differences, how it is changing by orientation, what are the consequences. You can think about it on the material behavior, on the microstructure evolution. And of course, as I mentioned already, the macroscopic strain hardening curve is also coming out from the simulation work. So so many information are coming out that I call it crystal plasticity modeling and simulation is one of the most rich and effective way to do simulation work on material behavior. Of course, your material has to be crystalline. Otherwise, it's not applicable. So, black box, input, output. Before input, there is preparation work. And also, after output, there is also analysis work. So you might get these, okay, but this is just going to be a file containing data. You have to examine it. Then you have to use further softwares to visualize them and to analyze them. So actually, the analysis of all this, which is here, requires especially here the ODF and pole figure presentations need further softwares, which work like this also. So, you know, this kind of work is repeating in our research life all the time. I'm going to give you also teaching on how to do that, especially for representation of pole figures and ODFs with the most developed and most recent application software techniques. Any question on this general talking? You can make questions anytime. Yes, possible.
The velocity you mentioned, I didn't quite understand. Velocity of what?
Velocity gradient of the material element, material deformation. So we have velocity field. We have a material. We want to deform it. It's going to be deformed, yeah. And then there is going to be during deformation a velocity field in the material. This velocity field, if it is constant, material doesn't deform. Just rigid body motion or rigid body motion belongs to a certain velocity field. But if you have a gradient in it, meaning that neighbor points, they move with different speeds, that includes stretches, deformation of the material. That's the velocity. So what we need actually is the derivative of this velocity as a function of position, the location of the material point. And that's what we call the so-called velocity gradient tensor. This is what we need in crystal plasticity. This is not symmetric, not necessarily symmetric. It contains the normal rigid body rotation, which is no deformation. It contains also the deformation part. And our crystal plasticity code will be automatically analyzing it and permitting to to obtain all this which I explained before. So this is the quantity which is we need in crystal plasticity, the so-called velocity gradient. All crystal plasticity codes are need this as an input. For example, the Los Alamos famous VPSC code, or the less famous but equally performant METS VPSC code, and they are needing this quantity for the material element. And this belongs to one material element. And this coming from somewhere on a certain trajectory, it's varying during the movement. You look at the same material point before and during its evolution. And that's what we need during its evolution to supply to the code. If you know that, then a simulation will be possible. That's one ingredient. The other is the orientation set. So each crystal has an orientation. Yeah?
The yield surface you are getting it for the crystal, it is generalized yield surface. The yield surface which you have presented for the single crystal.
Yes?
It is generalized one. Why it is shifting from the axis?
The representation of a crystal is a general.
On one slide you have presented a yield surface.
The first, which slide? Let's go back. Oh no, this one, this direction. Here?
Previous
here. Yeah.
Is this a generalized yield surface for a single crystal?
Yeah, it looks like that. If we use the so-called Schmidt law, strain rate insensitive theory, then it looks like something like that, a single crystal. In a given orientation, it is not symmetric. This crystal is not oriented symmetrically with respect to the reference system. That's why it looks, but this is schematic. But this is how it looks like, more or less. It's easy to obtain and trace it. Because you made this question, perhaps I will ask you a special homework to trace one of them, and then you will be really understanding. Okay, we will discuss and I will define it for you, how to obtain that so-called yield locus. Any other question?
So when giving the input of velocity gradient,
yeah.
So is it an instantaneous velocity gradient between the two neighboring points or the overall velocity gradient?
Yes, that there will be plenty of examples.
VPSC model, and they are getting a fantastic, enormous amount of information, which is physically very relevant and true. Okay. Orientations we will represent by either angles. So other angles. I'm using the Runge notation. It's not very specific. It's 3 angles, 515, 52. Here. So there are two reference systems. One is the crystal reference system, and the other is the sensor in which we are going to put this crystal into. And we have to make transformation between the two. We have to know how to go from one system to the other. Because we know the crystal characteristics in its own reference system. But then we put it into the machine and deform it, and we orient it somehow. So its orientation can be described with 3 angles. The 5-1, the 5, and the 5-2 angles. They are simply, and the first point size is the 2 reference systems. So these are the 3 axes. Then, like in a crystal reference system, usually it's like a cubic axis, you know, it's like 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, and 1, 0, 0. The 3 basic axes of the crystal in cubic, the hexagonal is different. We look at the 2. And then we rotate around, we rotate the crystal around axis 1, axis 3, sorry, axis 3, with angle phi 1. That will bring this axis here, and that axis is going there. So these are the new axes, x1 prime, x2 prime is here. And then we rotate around the new x1 axis. The new x1 axis is here by an angle of phi. That will change the orientation of the x3 axis with the value of phi. And finally, the last change will be around x3 prime axis by angle of phi 2. So actually, there are rotations only around two axes. Of the crystal. One is the x3, the other is the x1. Run x3 twice at the beginning, and once around the x1, the new x1, and then again rotate the x3, you take and make another orientation. These are the so-called Euler Bunge type of angles. Bunge, you have to know his name. He is considered to be the father of texture studies. He was a German fellow, and in the beginning, of 60s, he was working on it first in the East Germany, and then he was taken, practically, was bought or transferred from East Germany to West Germany, where he established a whole texture laboratory, which was basically the center of texture research initially. And then he made the texture representation with harmonic coefficients. So these are kind of Fourier series, but with spherical harmonics, spherical harmonic representation, because orientations is only rotation. So you can learn the spherical harmonics. So he established how to represent the texture in a describe in a mathematical way, with a big impact in science. I knew him actually, and appreciate very much. Now, since he died in 2005, there is a Bunge Prize, which is given every 3 years only to eminent scientists. So not only the orientation is important for representing the crystal, but in the simulation work, we need to know about the size, the volume of that crystal. Because in terms of forces it can make, the contribution to the stress state, if it is big grain or small grain, it's not the same. So from the mechanics point of view, we need the volume of the crystal. So we are actually making a file for practically to put it into the polycrystal code. We make a file in which there are the angles numerically phi 1, phi 2, and the volume fraction of that grain. So this orientation, which is called crystal orientation, of course, if you write, for example, a program where you have an existing code and you modify it, you are programming actually, physically. And then the difficulty is that you make a changes, introduce some new things, and the whole thing is not working. So now you have to look for bugs. So it's the same thing. In the modeling simulation, these are the bugs, what you have to find all the time. Frustrating, but always a big success when you find one. So we can continue, but not for long, because I got the information that I can also ask for breaks. And I think it will be a common asking. So after this, you know, we got we have got already some ideas, some understanding what the problem is and what is the construction of the problem. And if you go into it progressively, by the end, physically, you will be able to do simulation work using your, hopefully, your own data, and then put into your paper, and then to publish.